really hand in hand with that one. As we sing there, stand up for Jesus. It says the battle will not be long. This day the noise of victory, the next the victor's song. And I, for one, have been far too often guilty of just not getting in the battle to start with. Not doing battle for the Lord, not taking a stand as I should, and doing battle on a daily basis for the cause of Christ. And that's what this song calls us to. It says, "O church, arise." If you're not familiar with it, please listen to the words. Got a beautiful message to it. Soul, but to rage against the captor. Father, I pray that you would move and work in our hearts, Lord, to draw us into a deeper relationship with you, Father, so that we may be equipped, so that we may be ready on a daily basis to go and to do battle for the cause of Christ in this world. Speak to our hearts now through your word. In Jesus' name, amen.
Chapter 8. I like that last song, don't you? I don't know it very well, but I really like that last song. It has a great, great message. Of course, the captain of our army does call out to us to get in the fight and to get on the battlegrounds. And really, to be honest, you're in the fight, you're in the battlegrounds. You may not be fighting much, and you may feel defeated, but you are in a battle every moment of every day when your feet get forward. So that's a great reminder. Well, there's soup back there. And there's more soup back there, and there's more soup back there. And then there's a cake that would feed all of Cleveland County back there that Jerry McCarty said this morning was for me, Roger, and Paul only. I heard it. I wasn't the only one that heard it. So I liked the way he was thinking. And so since he made this morning that comment about the short stack thing, then I think we're just going to take the cake, Roger. I think that's our cake. And so anyway, we will. I will be brief tonight, so I can get you back there to that soup and have some time of fellowship. I don't want you to be out late tonight. I would hate for any Baptist to be out late on a Sunday night, just as bad as I would hate for any Baptist to have to sit in their pew past 12 o'clock. I want to talk to you tonight about a seated priest and his new covenant. Hebrews chapter 8. If you've been keeping up, you know that we have skipped chapter 7. We have not skipped chapter 7. We're going to talk some about it. We're just not going to read through the whole chapter, because in verse 1, chapter 8, and we talked about verse 1, chapter 8 last Sunday night, it says, now the main point of what is being said is this. We have this kind of high priest who sat down at the right hand of the throne of the majesty in the heavens. He's a minister of the sanctuary and the true tabernacle that was set up by the Lord and not man. That's what we read last Sunday night. Let's go on to verse 3. It says, for every high priest is appointed to offer gifts and sacrifices. Therefore, it was necessary for this priest also to have something to offer. Now, if he were on earth, he wouldn't be a priest, since there are those offering the gifts prescribed by the law. These serve as a copy and shadow of the heavenly things. As Moses was warned when he was about to complete the tabernacle, for God said, be careful that you make everything according to the pattern that was shown to you on the mountain. But Jesus has now obtained a superior ministry, and to that degree he is the mediator of a better covenant, which has been legally enacted on better promises. Now, as you read through the book of Hebrews, you'll notice they must have been Baptists, or we must get our line and lineage directly from the specific people that he was writing to here, because he repeats himself a lot in the book of Hebrews. And if you'll notice, in Baptist churches, if you're going to do anything that's not just the normal routine, you should repeat yourself often, really often. Now, we haven't, as far as I know, the money hasn't been counted, but I'd be willing, I'm not a betting man. I don't do that. We're Baptists. My grandpa said, we don't bet, we bound. And so I would bound you to hope that somewhere in the money that was taken up in those red buckets this morning for the Gideons, someone placed a tithe offering in that bucket. I would be willing to bet my life that that took place this morning. You know why? Because we always take up our offering. If we're going to take up a love offering, we do it towards the end, not at the beginning. Let me tell you what our young adults are doing. They're raising kids just like them. All right, here's what happened this morning. This morning I come in, and I had not talked to Miss Linda about taking up an offering in the way that I did this morning. She's been doing the change for children. She had the red buckets out. Well, the red buckets that she had out looked a little bit better than the red buckets that I had in my office to take up the love offering. So I'm thinking, well, I need to get those buckets. And so what I did is I swapped them out. Now, I didn't tell Miss Linda, I didn't tell anybody else. I just swapped them out and I put different red buckets back there. When the kids come in and saw those three red buckets sitting right here, they grabbed them and went and sat down. I said, well, what are you doing? And they said, well, we got to have these red buckets to take up the change for children. We were told that, you know, we have red buckets. These are the red buckets that we take up the change for children. I thought, that's only like a 3-week tradition. How do you know that? And so they had those red buckets. And I said, no, boys. I said, I've got different red buckets already back there. And at the end of the service, now listen, we took those and put those up here and put the money and everything in them, had them sitting there. At the end of the service, those boys took those buckets and they began to empty out the change. And I just was still standing there because I had to prayer with Heather Paul. I said, boys, what are you doing? And C.J. Parks looked at me and he said, they told me I had to have these red buckets to take up the chain. And he said, I told them, Brother Doug said different, but they told me Brother Doug didn't know what he was talking about. Well, I'm doing what I'm told. To which I replied, put the red bucket down. There is another red bucket back there. The book of Hebrews, as you read through the book, man, it just goes on and on and on. He repeats himself over and over and over. And the reason is that he is trying to drive home a point that Jesus is superior to everything in their religious practice. We walked into a restaurant this afternoon right after church. I don't remember which of the kids I had with me, and Alicia had some, one or two with her. So we get out and we're walking in, and there was a lady, she had accidentally walked into Mac's restaurant with her Bible, you know, in her hand. And so when she comes back out, she's got that Bible in her hand. And there's a lady rolls down the window. I don't know if they knew each other or not, but she said, boy, you must be real religious carrying your Bible to lunch, even after church. And my immediate thought when someone says that, I know why we say those things. My immediate thought is, well, I hope you're not religious. I hope you have a relationship with Jesus.
Right.
So much of what even we do in the church is a religious practice. I mean, we come, and we sit, and when Paul asks us to stand, and we get a little aggravated that we have to stand so long, and then we sit down. Even on Sunday nights, I mean, Sunday nights is like a ritual. I mean, we do the same thing every Sunday night. We have three songs. Then Brother Paul prays. And after he prays, that's my cue to come up. And he prays for the sermon, and he asks God to speak to us. I come up, and I preach. And then right after my sermon, we'll have an invitation. And then we'll all go home. Now, there's nothing wrong with that. There's nothing wrong with that unless you get stuck in it. That's the only way you can have Sunday night worship. Now, I know that's taking it a little to the extreme, but there are certain ways that we do things. There are certain buckets we take up our offering in, right? I mean, there are certain ways that we do things. He is preaching against religion here. He's preaching against religion, and he's preaching pro-relationship. He's preaching about Jesus, and that Jesus having a relationship with him is point number one. I don't know why this is a two-point day, but it's just a two-point message again tonight. We have a heavenly high priest. We have a heavenly high priest. Now, he says that the main point of what is being said is this. We have this kind of high priest who is set down at the right hand of the throne of the majesty in the heavens. That's verse 1 of chapter 8. And so what he's saying is the main point of everything that's in chapter 7 is found in verse 1 of chapter 8. What's in chapter 7? Well, what's in chapter 7? He mentions Melchizedek again. Now, again, I've told you that I believe that Melchizedek was an Old Testament Christophany. It was a moment where Christ showed up. I believe Melchizedek is Christ himself. I could be wrong, but the writer of Hebrews seems to allude to the fact that he was Christ himself. I had a guy call me from out of state. This has been it's right before I came up here. And so it's been a little 4 years ago, and he called me and he asked me, he said, have you ever preached on Melchizedek before? And I said, well, I have. I mean, you know. And he said, well, who do you believe Melchizedek was? I said, I believe Melchizedek was Christ. And he said, well, me and you need to sit down and talk. I hung up the phone and thought, I just need to pray about that. Maybe God will tell me different if I'm wrong. And then I got mad and I got over it. But anyway, Melchizedek is alluded to here as being Christ. Now, if he wasn't Christ, then at least he was an illustration of who Christ would be. I mean, you can't argue with that because he talks about that we have this kind of high priest. What does that mean, this kind of high priest? Well, if you look back in chapter 7, beginning in verse 1, it says, for this Melchizedek, king of Salem, priest of the Most High God, who met Abraham and blessed him as he returned from defeating the kings, and Abraham gave him a tenth of everything. First, his name means king of righteousness. Sounds like Jesus to me. And then it says, king of Salem, meaning king of peace. Now, I know that in Isaiah chapter 6, it tells us, or in the book of Isaiah, it tells us that Jesus would be the prince of what? Peace. The prince of peace. And so it says the meaning of the king of Salem is the king of peace. And it says in verse 3, it says, without father, mother, or genealogy. having neither beginning of days nor end of life, but resembling the Son of God. And then it goes on to say that he remains a priest forever. Now, if this guy Melchizedek wasn't Jesus, he had a beginning. Now, just because we don't know that he had a beginning, we know he had a beginning. You know, I made the statement to some kids one time about, you know, your parents, your dad. And one of the kids said, I don't have a dad. And I said, son, that's impossible. You have a dad. So, no, I don't have a dad. And what he meant was, I've never met my dad. But you have a dad. I mean, it's impossible to have a child without having a father and a mother. Now, it's contrary to culture belief right now, but it's impossible to have a child without having a mother and a father. And you may have a dad. There's a difference between being a father and being an actual dad. I know that, but you have a father. Melchizedek would have had a beginning, but the Bible says in the New Testament that he had no beginning. Now, I understand that there are New Testament scholars who tell us that what that means is that there's no recorded beginning. And it's possible. It's possible. But I just kind of like to take it for what it is. And if you look at the various translations of the Bible, all the various translations, I mean, the respected translations of the Bible. I don't look at the unrespected, but the respected translations of the Bible talk about that he had no beginning of days. Also, as you look through, you'll see that the king of Salem, it means king of peace. And not only that, but Abraham offered him a tent, which was a tithe, which was only given to God. And so, and he received it. He received it freely. He also received worship from Abraham freely. Why would Abraham have worshipped anyone other than God himself? And it wasn't an angel, because as you see throughout all of the Old and New Testament, when someone comes and offers worship to an angel, the angel will tell you, don't worship me. I'm not the one you need to worship. The one you need to worship is the one that I worship, the King of Kings and the Lord of Lords. And so I believe it's Jesus. Could I be wrong? Probably not, but I mean, I could be. I mean, I guess it's possible. I could be wrong. We have a heavenly high priest, and we have this kind of high priest. He was without beginning, and he has no end of life. He is the eternal high priest. And you understand, in the culture, the Hebrew culture of the day, they had a high priest who would live, but then he would die. And then they would have a new high priest of the Levitical tribe. And so they knew what this was. They knew what that, but to have one with no beginning and to have one with no end, in that day, there are those that it would just simply not have made sense to. The Bible also says in chapter 7 and verse 24, it says, but because he remains forever, now this is Jesus, because he remains forever, he holds his priesthood permanently, which makes sense if he remains forever, right? Therefore, he is always able to save those who come to God through him, since he always lives to intercede for them. This is our high priest. His name is Jesus. We have a heavenly high priest. Now, in this church, the majority of the people in this room would say, well, I know we have a heavenly high priest. His name is Jesus. But do you realize the greatness of having a heavenly high priest? What does he do? He intercedes on our behalf. You say, well, why does he need to intercede on our behalf? Because we're cotton-picking sinners and we're good at it. We need an intercessor. We need an in-between between us and the wrath of God. You realize that the Catholic faith, the majority of the Catholic faith, now I know there are some that are more evangelical than others, but at the heart of the Catholic faith, the reason that they pray to Mother Mary is because they believe that Son Jesus is angry because their sin nailed him to the cross. That's the reason to pray through Mother Mary. Now the only issue with that was it wasn't his anger that nailed him to the cross, it was the Father's anger because of our sin that nailed him to the cross. And he went there not because he just had to fulfill some duty, although I do believe that the Father's will was certainly on his mind. You see it in the garden just a few nights before. But the reason that he went there was out of love. For God so loved the world that he gave his only begotten Son. Amen. It was because of love that nailed him to the cross. I don't need Mother Mary or any other saint mother to pray through to get to the heart of Jesus. I am at the heart of Jesus. And guess what? He is in my heart. Amen. Now listen, I know it's Sunday night and I know it's soup in the kitchen. I understand. But listen, He died on the cross. He died on the cross, yes, to pay the penalty to God. Yes, no doubt. And no doubt he prayed that his will be done. And that was his will. But he died on the cross simply because he loved you and I. And y'all listen, I mean, there's some deep truths in this word, and I know, and there's some things in here we can't, you know, who was Melchizedek? I mean, we don't know for sure. But I know that Jesus Christ, the Nazarene, loves me. And I know he loves you. And I know he loves each and every man, woman, boy, and girl on planet Earth at this very moment in history. Everyone that'll be born. Little Luke is going to come into the world tomorrow. God willing, he's going to come into the world tomorrow. Apparently very early. They're going to leave about 5:30 to head down that way. When he comes in to planet Earth, God loves him. Now listen, I know we are pro-lifers, and so we understand that his life doesn't begin tomorrow. He is alive even now. Amen?
Amen.
We know that. But when they first lay eyes on that little baby and the mom and dad with all the joy that goes through that, as much as they can love him at that moment, it pales in comparison to the greatness of the love of Jesus, that little baby. Now listen, all of you who work Awana on those rough nights, we have a little boy who looked me right in the eye. We were trying to load the bus, and I call out the names. I said, Austin, called his last name, no move. But oh, good gracious, we've lost him. He's a kindergartner. He never finds his way home. We've lost him. So I go back to the back, and I find the one that I think, I didn't know his last name, but I think it's him. And I asked him, I said, Austin, is your last name? And I called his last name. He looked at me, and he said, no, sir, it's Levi. I said, you sure that's not your middle name? That sounds more like a middle name. Then, like, no, sir. He said, my name's not that. No, sir. He convinced me. I come back out, and I told Barbara, who was over the buses, I said, well, there's an Austin back there. It's not the right one. He's waiting on his mama back. I said, look what he's waiting on his mama. And so we load the bus, and we leave. I mean, all buses are on the road. And my wife and I think Mr. Parks were the only two that were left in Austin. And they go to leave, and they said, well, Austin, and it said, he said, well, he said, I was just playing with Brother Doug. My name really is. Called his last name. So they had to call Mom. Mom had to come get him. Actually, they had to call the bus to come back this way, thinking they were going to have to get him. Mom beats the bus and all that. So I told him this last name. I said, Austin, me and you need to talk. He had on a tuxedo coat, for those of you who remember who Austin is. I said, listen, if you ever lie to me again, squash you like a bug. I said, son, a lot of things have to happen at the right time. Loading those buses are one of them. We got to get those buses loaded and get you home. I mean, if we have to call Mom too many times, she might not let you come back. Quiz it ain't say, I'm sorry, Bubba Dog. And then later on that night, he saw me walking down the hallway. He said, hey, it's my buddy. Well, you tell me the truth, I'm your buddy. And those hard nights, and then we have it. On those hard nights, those nights that you just, you know, you just grab one in the love of Jesus. On those hard nights, don't forget the simple truth. One, Jesus loves me, this I know. And two, he loves that child just as much as he loves me. He died for that little boy, died for that little girl. He gave his life. That's why we do what we do. And you have to do that with children, and your pastor has to do that with you sometimes. Some days are not easy. Some days are difficult. You should be up here and actually have to work with that humble Roger Rucker every day. It's hard. I mean, it is what it is. Listen, Jesus loves us. Amen. He cares for us. He died for us. I had to get that in. I thought, you know, Jerry said all that about me and mentioned Shortstack. And then he mentions Roger. And the worst thing he says about Roger is, I fall in love more and more with Roger. He's so humble, I thought. I'm humble now. You beat me down. That's not humble. We have this kind of high priest. Listen, This kind of high priest had no beginning, it had no end. Revelation 1 and verse 8 says, I am the Alpha and Omega, says the Lord, the one who is, the one who was, and the one who is coming, the Almighty. He is an eternal God, an eternal God. And he's seated. He's seated at the right hand of the Father. Why is he seated at the right hand of the Father? You know this. It's just a reminder. He's seated at the right hand of the Father because when he was on the cross, he cried out, it is finished. The word in Greek means it's paid for, paid in full. It's accomplished. The Bible says in Romans chapter 7, and we'll go right into Romans chapter 8 and read four verses out of 8 as well. But beginning in Romans 7 and verse 13, it says, therefore, did what is good cause my death? He said, absolutely not, the Apostle Paul says. On the contrary, sin, in order to be recognized as sin, was producing death in me through what is good, so that through the commandment, sin might become sinful beyond measure. For we know that the law is spiritual, but I am made out of flesh, sold into sin's power. For I do not understand what I am doing, because I do not practice what I want to do, but I do what I hate. And if I do, what I do not want to do, I agree with the law that it is good. So now, I am no longer the one doing it, but it is sin living in me. For I know that nothing good lives in me, that is, in my flesh. For the desire to do what is good is with me, but there is no ability to do it. For I do not do the good that I want to do, but I practice the evil that I do not want to do. Now, if I do what I do not want, I am no longer the one doing it, but it is the sin that lives in me. So I discovered this principle. When I want to do what is good, evil is in me. For in the inner self, I joyfully agree with God's law. But I see a different law in the parts of my body, waging war against the law of my mind and taking me prisoner to the law of sin in the inner parts of my body. What a wretched man I am. Who will rescue me from this dying body? I thank God through Jesus Christ our Lord. So then, with my mind, I myself am a slave to the law of God, but with my flesh to the law of sin. Therefore, no condemnation now exists for those in Christ Jesus. Boy, that's a great verse. Because the Spirit's law of life in Christ Jesus has set you free. Free from the law of sin and death. What the law could not do, since it was limited by the flesh, God did. He condemned sin in the flesh by sending His own Son in flesh like ours under sin's domain and as a sin offering in order that the law's requirement be accomplished in us who do not walk according to the flesh but according to the Spirit. What the Apostle Paul has just said there, it's an over-exaggeration of what sin is in our life. And it says that sin being nailed down in the inner man and the inner workings of who we are because we were born into a sinful fleshly being. Because of that, he says that when I could no longer control it, Jesus took it over and Jesus paid our sin debt. He took the sin and he imputed righteousness into us, not because of who we are, but because of who he is in us. And because of that, there is therefore no condemnation to those who are in Christ Jesus. Not who like Christ Jesus. Not who say amen to the sermons about Christ Jesus. Not who carry Bibles and go to Baptist churches and who have been baptized. But those who are in, place their life inside of the life of Jesus Christ. And better than that, it's He who has placed His life inside of the sinful man. Can you imagine? That God not only, the Hebrew people of the day were trying to get over the fact that God would leave heaven and come down to earth and would be here as a Messiah who would be nailed to a cross and not set up a kingdom here. And then now, What we preach is not only did he come and did he die, that he would set up a kingdom, but it's not an earthly kingdom, it's a heavenly kingdom. But it's even better than that. He came, he lived, he died to set up a heavenly kingdom. But he came, he lived, and he died to make his home, his abode, inside of a sinful man like me. And because of that, there is therefore no condemnation of those who are in Christ Jesus. Listen, I walk in the freedom of Christ even when I sin. I walk in the freedom of Christ. And listen, I don't sin so that you know I walk in the freedom of Christ. As the Apostle Paul would say, God forbid that take place. Absolutely not. But when I do sin, I don't wonder if I'm going to die and go to heaven because I told a lie. I know I'm going to die and go to heaven because Jesus paid it all. Listen, when you talk about Jesus being our great heavenly high priest, what, as the writer said, what a lovely name, this name called Jesus. What a beautiful, beautiful name. And so, we have a heavenly high priest, and then point number two, and we'll wrap up pretty quick. We have a new covenant. Heavenly covenant. He says in verse 7, he says of Hebrews 8, he says, for if that first covenant had been faultless, there would have been no occasion for a second one. Now just stop right there. Here's what he just said. He said, if the old covenant, the Abrahamic covenant, if that would have been faultless, and if the law could have covered our sin, then we would not have need of a new one. In other words, if the law would have covered it, if the Old Testament law that the Hebrew people kept, if that would have covered it, then Jesus wouldn't have had to come. There had been no need for a Messiah. There had been no need for a Savior because we could have been saved through the Old Testament law. Listen, Abraham wasn't saved through the Old Testament law. Moses was not saved through the Old Testament law. Ezekiel was not saved through the Old Testament law. They were saved by grace, saved by faith through grace. Because they had placed their faith and trust in Jehovah God and believed in Him. And even more than that, they believed, looking ahead at something they had never seen, that the Messiah would come. They trusted in Him for their salvation, though they had not seen Him. They believed the Word of God to the point that they knew there would be a Savior. They placed their life in the hands of the Savior. They are saved just like we're saved. The difference is we have the indwelling Holy Spirit once we are saved. That's the main crux of the new covenant. That the Holy Spirit comes and lives in us. He says that if the first covenant had been faultless, we'd have no occasion for a second one. You remember what Peter said on the day of Pentecost? He talks and he says that this is the Spirit of heaven that has come down on man. And he says that we have hung a yoke on our own necks that neither we nor our ancestors were able to bear. We know we can't be faultless before a holy God. That's the reason that God sent Jesus. And the Bible says that there were over 3,000 souls that were saved that day because he just simply preached the good news that the law wasn't done away with, but the law has been fulfilled in Christ Jesus. There's the new covenant. He says in verse 8, he says, but finding fault with his people, and this is his, capital H, this is God says, finding fault with his people, he says, look, the days are coming, says the Lord, when I will make a new covenant. By the way, this is found in Jeremiah 31. It's a direct quote from Jeremiah 31, verses 31 through 34. It says, look, the days are coming, says the Lord, when I will make a new covenant with the house of Israel and with the house of Judah. Not like the covenant that I made with their ancestors on the day I took them by their hands and led them out of the land of Egypt. I disregarded them, says the Lord, because they did not continue my covenant. But this is the covenant I will make with the house of Israel. After those days, says the Lord, I will put my laws in their minds and write them on their hearts. I will be their God, and they will be my people. And each person will not teach his fellow citizen and his brother, saying, know the Lord, because they will all know me, from the least to the greatest of them. And for I will be merciful to their wrongdoing, and I will never again remember. By saying a new covenant, he has declared that the first is old, and what is old and aging is about to disappear. He talks about the new covenant. And inside of this new covenant, you and I are born again. It's because of this new covenant with Jesus that he has made with his Father on our behalf interceding on our behalf. You remember chapter 7 in verse 25 that he's there and he lives to intercede for them. The them is us. All right, it's us. Everybody in this room, he intercedes. It's because of that, there's been a blood covenant that has been paid for. And as an 8-year-old boy, I placed my faith and trust in Jesus Christ and became a part of this new covenant. And at that point, I didn't realize it. I didn't understand it. And frankly, I don't understand it even as I stand here today. But as an 8-year-old boy, when I placed my faith and trust in Jesus through repentance and faith, I was placed and engrafted in to the Israel that he's talking about here. I don't fully understand it all even today. I'm still studying. And I've got an idea. Whenever I die and see Jesus, that is the only time I'll fully understand it. But it was at that moment that I was engrafted in to the tree that was cut off, but the trunk that remained, I was engrafted in to the line of lineage, the house of Jesse, as the book of Romans tells me. That doesn't make me an Israelite. It makes me a part of the kingdom of God. And I said, I'm pro-Israel. I mean, if you're not pro-Israel, you need to read your Bible. I understand that. But I'm not so pro-Israel that I get so caught up in that, that I miss the real meaning of being a part of the kingdom of God. Because every Israelite on planet Earth, if they do not know Jesus as their Lord and Savior, they're going to die and go to hell. Just like every Arcanian, if they don't know Jesus, they're going to die and go to hell. Remember, the main point here is not the Israelites. The main point, in A.D. 381, there was a man who wrote these words, and they're still just as true today as they were the day he wrote them. Talking about Jesus, it says, Jesus ended his earthly ministry by being thirsty, yet he is the living water. Jesus was weary, and yet he is our rest. Jesus paid tribute, and yet he is the king. Jesus was accused of having a demon, and yet he cast out demons. Jesus wept, yet he wipes away our tears. Jesus was sold for 30 pieces of silver, and yet he redeemed the world. Jesus was brought as a lamb to the slaughter, yet he is the good shepherd. Jesus died, yet by his death he destroyed the power of death. Jesus is the stamp on the new covenant. The whole point of Hebrews chapters 1 through 8 is that Jesus is superior. Now, as you get into chapter 9, he begins to talk about this old covenant and this new covenant and begins to break it apart. But the point is still that Jesus is superior. And then you get into chapter 10 and talks about the perfect sacrifice. The point is that Jesus is superior. Because you see, there were those of the Hebrew faith, those Jewish people of the day that were still following Old Testament law. They were still working their way up to have a relationship with God. Just, you know, just one step away from really having a relationship with God. And yet they were one step away. And the writer of Hebrews says, yeah, that step you missed, his name is Jesus. He's the one that you yelled out, crucify, crucify, crucify. So, if you look at the book of Hebrews, how would you describe the book of Hebrews? Jesus is great. Jesus is great. He is the greatest thought in human history, this man called Jesus. That's the meaning of the book. He just wants to show us that Jesus is great. So, I'm going to put it in and we'll try to apply it to everyday life. I don't like preaching if you can't apply it. So, let's apply it. What are you going through this week? Just think. What are you headed into this week? You know, there are those who say you're either going through a storm, you just come out of one, or you're just about to head into one. Jesus is great. But what are you going through? Are you like the disciples? Are you out there, and man, you're on the bow of that ship, and the waves are coming, and that boat's going down? This sucker, we're sinking here. Jesus, cares not thou that we perish? Oh, yeah, he cares. How do I know he cares? He's our great heavenly high priest. He's our intercessor. He's seated at the right hand of the throne of God, and as Satan makes his appeal on our sinful behalf, Jesus steps in and says, now that's all true. Doug is a sinner. Doug has fallen short of your glory, Father. He has, no doubt. He does it every day of his life. But don't forget I covered that. Don't forget I paid it. And he's believed. He's trusted in me. He's given me his life. And so don't forget not what he's done, but don't forget what I've done for what he's done. And so he intercedes on our behalf. He's the filter that filters out our sinful thoughts and our sinful prayers. And when the Bible says in the book of Romans chapter 8 that when we don't know what to pray, the Spirit intercedes. The Spirit prays. And who does the Spirit pray to? In the name of Jesus. Amen. And that's the one who's working on our behalf. And I'm just going to tell you, you can come tell me you work on my behalf, and you may do it. But when you prove to me that you're working on my behalf, you've got my full trust. And Jesus proved it on Calvary. He did all the work for me. He doesn't have anything left to prove for me. And listen, if he blesses me not one more time, he's done enough. As a matter of fact, he's done too much in my life. He's done way too much in my life. I promise you, as I'm standing up here this morning, it really was one of the most uncomfortable. I mean, that's just uncomfortable. Now, I appreciate it, and I'm thankful for it. And all it's uncomfortable. You know, stand up here, we're going to brag about you, Brother Doug. I mean, don't do that. Now I have Paul and Roger to stand with. At least I'm not just me and Paul just standing up there and y'all just bragging on us. But I promise you, you think much higher of me than I do. And I don't mean I have this weird self problem. I don't mean that. I just know me better than you do. And I know I'm not worthy to be a pastor of any church. I know I'm not worthy to stand and even just hold the Bible open for someone else to preach. I know that. But I can. Because Jesus is great. Amen. So I don't know what you're headed through this week. I don't know what I'm headed through this week in full. But I know this. Come what may, Jesus is great. Sure. Somebody asked me this week about the building program. And I'm excited. I wanted to share it this morning. We just run out of time. So if the Sunday night crowd gets to hear this, probably before anybody else does. But this Friday is the last day for contractors to turn in the bid. We will know this Friday within just a few thousand dollars what this building will cost. And for so long, I mean, we're guessing. We think we've got a good estimated guess by the architect. We don't know. We don't know. They may come back with $10 million. If they do, we ain't built it, all right? Just tell you. No, we think it's going to be down around 2, and that's what we've talked about for months. Somebody asked me this last week, said, you know, I heard that building's about to be, y'all about to get rolling. I said, yeah. Makes me nervous a little bit. They said, well, aren't you worried about, you know, churches split over this kind of stuff? And people get up and leave the church over this kind of stuff. And aren't you worried about it? I said, no. No, that doesn't worry. And I told them, I said, the only thing that worries me is that can our church be sure to keep Jesus the main thing as that building's going up? Because if we make that building the main thing, then we are in trouble. And that's where churches get off track. They lose focus on Jesus. And Jesus gets us through the building program. And he's greater than that. He's greater than anything we'll face as a church body. He's greater than anything you'll face as an individual or as a family. And listen, the only way to fully know that is to come to a relationship with him through repentance and faith and trust in him. So if you don't have that, you'll never understand this idea that he's great. But once you step into a relationship with him, it all begins to make sense. I don't mean you understand everything in the Bible. But everything will line up and begin to make sense for you once you know the one who created you and who is greater than anything you'll go through. I'm thankful that whoever the writer was, the book of Hebrews wrote it, as a reminder to me Jesus is great. Let's pray. We're going to have a time of invitation. And I'm going to invite you, if God spoke to your heart, to do business with Him. Now, the last few Sundays, the altars have been filling up. We've had people that are making some type of decision for the Lord in a lot of different ways. And I want you to know the altars are open tonight as well. Altars open for any reason that you may want to come. You may just want to come and kneel down and just say, thank you, Lord, that Jesus is greater in my life. I'm thankful for that. Maybe you want to come and kneel and pray for someone that you know doesn't know that He's greater. Maybe they have a religious relationship with the church, but they don't have a relationship with Jesus, and you know that. You see that in their lives. And you will come and kneel and pray for them. Maybe there's other things that God would has spoken to your heart, and you need to come and kneel and pray, that's fine as well. I know it's a Sunday night crowd, a lot of Christians in this room, but if you're here tonight and you don't know Jesus as your Lord and Savior, you all of a sudden realize right now, if I die, I go to a place called hell, then I'm going to encourage you to come. And let's meet this Jesus that I promise you is greater than anything that you're going through in your life. Father, we thank you so much that just for the simple truth that Jesus loves us, that He cares for us, that He died for us, and that He arose from the dead. Father, that is a truth that not only will I never get over, but I'll never fully understand. But I'm thankful for it. And Father, I pray that You'd help me to never get over that. Father, every time I read in Your Scripture about how much Jesus loves us, Father, I am reminded that yes, He really does. Father, thank you for that simple truth in my life that is also so deep I'll never dig down far enough to understand it. Now, Father, tonight, if there's someone here who doesn't know you as their personal Lord and Savior, I pray they know you before they leave this place. Father, there are others in this place that you're dealing with their heart, you're speaking to their heart. Father, maybe they're going through some difficult seasons in their life. Father, I pray that through your word you've shown them tonight, not through the preacher's words, but through your word, your son Jesus is greater. Father, thank you for that calm assurance. You move in this place tonight for your honor, for your glory. And it's in the name of Jesus we pray. Amen. Let's all stand if you need to come. You can come. And sing, You Are My King. you for all that you did have done for me and Roger and Paul. And I know I speak on their behalf whenever I thank you for that. And I'll do it again next Sunday because that's just what you do, right? But thank you so much. And I'm telling you, it's a privilege and an honor to be your pastor. And I know Roger and Paul, it's a privilege and honor to do the job that they do as well. So thank you for allowing us that privilege to do that. Thank you for all that you do for us. Y'all ready to eat?
Okay.
Ready to eat and have fellowship. Listen, if you did not come prepared to eat, we hope you stay and eat anyway. You come back, we've got soups of all kinds. Please take two bowls. We have plenty of soups. So you come and eat with us. And there, I'm telling you, there is a cake back there big enough to feed us all twice. I promise. It's a humongous cake. And so come and we'll eat and fellowship tonight. Now, I'm gonna ask you to do something tonight. I'm gonna ask you to let Paul and Heather go first. Now, here's why. They gotta leave the house at 5:30 in the morning to head down to have a baby. So I want them to eat first. So let's let them eat first. And when they get ready to go, sometimes when you're on staff, you just kind of feel like you just gotta keep staying. Paul, if you turn the light off tonight, I'm gonna fire you. All right? Don't you turn the light off. Go home and get some rest. Take your wife home and let her get some rest before she leaves. So if they slip out right in the middle of everything, then you just let them go. All right? And we'll pray for them. I've been asked to pray for Miss Hearn. Miss Blanche Hearn is going to have surgery on Wednesday. She's having a type of surgery on the back of her neck. And she's been putting it off and putting it off and putting it off. And the reason is, if something were to go wrong, she'd be paralyzed. So she's an older lady, and so there's just a lot of things that go with that. And so Miss Shelby asked me to remember her in prayer. If you don't know who that is, that's the ones who own the property right beside the church. It's the ones who gave the property in the back that we got the almost 2 acres back there. And so we're going to remember her in a word of prayer, and then we're going to ask a blessing over the soup, and we're going to let Paul and Heather and their family go first, and then we'll all follow them. Anything else needs to be said or done before we dismiss? Hopefully that will be fine. If I didn't, it's Roger's fault. Father, we just thank you tonight for the awesome privilege to be in your presence. Father, we thank you for your word. And Father, we thank you that we know that you hear us when we pray because we have this great heavenly high priest named Jesus. Father, we lift up Miss Blanche to you. And Father, we pray that you would be with her. She goes into surgery on Wednesday. And Father, we pray that surgery would go well and fine, and that she would come out of that surgery with all of the issues resolved. And Father, I don't know what all they are, but Lord, you do. So Father, I pray that you work in her life. And Father, I also pray that you be with Paul and Heather as they travel in the morning, and you keep them safe. The rest of the family that'll be going back and forth. Father, be with the birth of this little boy. Father, we do pray as we pray this morning. Healthy. And Father, and that Heather would be healthy as well. Father, you be with them through the next few days as it's a great joy to have a new baby. And Father, there's so many things that could go wrong, but Father, we're just placing it in your hands. Father, we pray that you would have full charge and full control over everything. And Father, give comfort and peace as they walk into that hospital in the morning. And Father, I also lift up Brother Leon, who is en route right now in West Africa. And Father, we pray that you be with him as he travels. He travels through the night. And Father, we pray that he have a safe flight and a great mission trip as he's there, and that many souls be saved, either while he's there or because of his presence. And Father, help him as he teaches church planters this week from your word. Father, again, we thank you for the ones who have prepared the meal that's back in the back. And Father, we pray that you bless them and bless the food to our bodies. And Father, you help us to serve you through it. In Jesus' name, amen.